child will be called the prophet of the highest, for you will go before the face of the Lord to prepare his way, to give knowledge of salvation to his people by the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, by with which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give light to those who sit in darkness in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace.
Jesus Christ, may you shine on my city like a lighthouse up above. Her streets are growing desperate, needing the one who once was and is and knew was coming back. All we know is our past, but just a touch of your love forgives all.
Thanks to the mercy of God by which the risen sun has come from heaven to shine on those living in the darkest slums and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet to peace. Free us from our prisons, Jesus, shine on my city.
Tres, dos, uno.
Yeah, all glory to the Most High, to the Most High. Yeah, all glory to the Most High, Jesus Christ. Yeah, all glory to the Most High, to the Most High. Yeah, all glory to the Most High, to the Most High. Yeah, all glory to the Most High, to the Most High. Yeah, all glory to the Most High, Jesus Christ. Yeah, all glory to the Most High, to the Most High. Yeah, all glory to the Most High, Jesus Christ.
I
love Jesus.
Jesus.
Good morning. Welcome to the Morning Devo with Bo O this Wednesday, 9-1, September 1st. Wow, man, we are coming up pretty soon. I mean, man, we're going to blink and it's going to be 2 years of doing these Devos. And Devo just is short for devotion. That's what this is. It's a short devotional time for those in at Calvary Christian Fellowship, you know, or beyond, you know, for those that want to learn the church or learn the Bible and you're not part of a church, or maybe you are and you haven't gone through actually the Bible or biblical books. I hope that you can join us for these times. I'm doing these every day, Monday through Friday at 9 o'clock. I've been on some travels to Rockport, Texas, did some devos from there, which was pretty fun. And so we're kind of almost done with the book of Thessalonians, and we're going to do Thessalonians chapter 4 today. Paul wrote this book, Paul the Apostle, and he wrote most of the New Testament. And so we dive into 1 Thessalonians. Super cool book. Absolutely awesome. You could always check out the archives at my YouTube channel, which is streaming live too at Bo Ouellette. So you could look at all the different books that I've been able to do and get through. And maybe you can go through those and just learn the Bible in a simple way. And, you know, a lot of people don't really take the time to read the Bible or get familiar with the topics there within. But we definitely do that here on the Morning Devo with Boo. So let's get into it this morning. Chapter 4, great chapter, really deals with our, you know, the most inner parts of our being, right? Things that a lot of people don't like to talk about, actually. So it says, "Let me add this, dear brothers. You already know how to please God in your daily living." And so Paul, again, before he launches into anything, he does a little affirmation. And that's always good. You see that? Hey, you already know how to please God in your daily living. For you know the commands we gave you from the Lord Jesus himself. So Paul's normal way of going about teaching was to share the things that he learned from Jesus Christ. And so he would share these commands, if you will, of Jesus. Things about how to live. Loving your neighbor. Loving God. What does that look like? Those kind of things. Hey, good morning, Marcia. It's really good to see you. Glad to be back. So thank you for welcoming back. It's always nice to be back in the desert. And it's super humid out in Texas, and it's super kind of moist here too. So a lot of rain in both places. So it says that you know how to please God. You know the commands that I gave you from the Lord Jesus Christ. And now it says, now we beg you, yes. And we demand of you in the name of the Lord Jesus that you live more and more closely to the ideal, God's will. And that's what we always want to do, is move always in God's will towards the ideal. And remember, there's always a real and there's an ideal. And hopefully you have an ideal in your mind of what is the ideal thing that we can do today to walk with God. What would the ideal look like in pleasing the Lord? And then there's the real, meaning the real is understanding our frailties, where we fall short. So he says, hey, I beg you, we demand of you in the name of the Lord Jesus that you live more and more closely to the ideal. So you get the idea that the Christian life is one of always wanting to move more closer to the ideal or living like Christ. And this is something that we do by allowing Christ to live through us, by asking God to do that work through us surrendering our lives. And that means even the most intimate parts of our life. And our sexuality is definitely one of the most intimate parts of our life, something that we want to hold on to very dear. So look at what it says. It says, "For God wants you to be holy and pure, and to keep clear of all sexual sin, so that each of you will marry in holiness and honor." Now, it's interesting to note, but back in those days, there were false teachings that went around, made their rounds, if you will, in the church for people not to marry, that it was actually a sin to marry. I know that sex in itself was bad. And so to marry implied having sex, that was bad. So some people taught it's not good to marry at all. And still, the culture of the Roman world was one of very much, I think, similar to today in a lot of ways. There was a lot of diversity that went on in the sexual culture. And here Paul says, hey, you know, what I want you guys just to remember about walking in holiness and purity is taking the intimate part of your life. And this morning, God, I want to give you the intimate part of me, that part of me that I want to own you know, and what I want to own is my sexuality. And Lord, I want to give that over to you. Now notice it says God wants you to be holy and pure and to give, to keep a clear and keep clear of all sexual sin. And so that each of you will marry in holiness. The idea is that holy marriage is good. And that it is a good thing to be married and to experience your sex lives within that context of marriage. And Paul's totally saying that's cool. He says, give honor to it. Walk in it in a holy way that you will engage in that married life, that you will know how to walk in marriage in a honorable way. And he says, not in a lustful passion as the heathen do. So not just, he says, like, the unbeliever just goes off of his whim. Just whatever he wants to do, he does. And the Christian is always saying, no, whatever I want to do, that I'm going to learn how to restrain. So this morning, God teach us to restrain, to have restraint in our life. Help us to commit even that fleshly appetite lust, sexual lust, over to you. Help us to lay those things down. And that is not an easy task for people. And sometimes it's so embarrassing for people to talk about that part of their life that they kind of ignore it. And that's a tragedy, especially to ignore something that is so prominent in the human being, as our sexuality is. That's such a common part of our life that we shouldn't ignore those kind of things. Hey, Michael, it's great to have you here. But notice it says, you know, let's not act in that, you know, that way that we were when we were non-believers, just going off of everything that we wanted to do with our intimacy. And he says, in their ignorance, they do it. Meaning when you were ignorant, think about it, when you were ignorant of God's ways, you did whatever you wanted to do. So he's saying, let's not continue to do that. And so we don't want to walk in that same way that we once did. And, you know, and that makes sense. I mean, we all grew up, and I don't know where you all grew up, but we can all remember maybe some of those times where, you know, you had an urge and you wanted to get that, you know, that itch scratched, so to speak. And sometimes that's how we've moved in our sexuality as well. And instead of, it says, giving that over to God and learning how to resist. So there is a place for resistance, of course, in our lives. Just think of a world that does not resist at all any sexual temptations. What would it look like in a world if you didn't have any restraint on sexual urges? Is that a good world? You know, is it good to live in passion, you know, this kind of lustful passion? What would a world look like if everybody just went on and did what they lustfully wanted to do and there was no restraint? It would be pretty, probably insane. So, you know, to show restraint is really a good thing. It's something that we want to pray for. So he says, and this also is God's will, that you never cheat in this matter by taking another man's wife. So again, he affirms them, says, hey, I know you guys know how to please God, but I want to just make sure you guys are really aware of these things about your sexuality. And again, back then, you know, divorce, different things were all there as well. And people being with other people, living together all the time, sleeping together all the time. These things were very common like it was today. And Paul says, hey, let's not go in these directions. And he says, because the Lord will punish you terribly for this, as we have solemnly told you before. And, you know, when the Bible teaches that kind of thing, like the Lord will punish, some people go, oh, that's it. I won't put the book down, you know. But I don't think necessarily we should do that. you know, God is the creator, and when God says something, and that is, you will be terribly punished, we have to look at it and go, well, hey, why? You know, maybe there's something really serious about unbridled lust, that sexual lust that we need to look at. Maybe there's a ramification for unbridled lust. Maybe there's a lot of pain that goes with unbridled lust. You know, maybe treating your neighbor wrong. You know, is it good to sleep with your neighbor's spouse? Is that a right action? You know, what is the consequences for these things? We should always be thinking along those lines and really be pondering that. Well, the Bible says God does have a judgment for us for our behavior. And that's something we need to look at and just be like, hey, that's what it teaches. Now, that's no different from society. If you do something wrong in society, you're going to be judged for it. So we shouldn't put down the book and just say, hey, you know, God, this morning I don't want to be punished, so therefore I'm not going to read your book or those sections because I don't want to talk about punishment. And this really is a struggle in our culture, because a lot of times we like to be affirmed so much that we don't like any kind of critique. And we don't like to think of any kind of repercussions or consequences for our behaviors. But yet it's important to think that way. We have to be thinking about consequences for behaviors, because if we never do, we'll never change. We'll never go maybe a different direction. Maybe I should think about recycling. Maybe recycling might benefit. Does that make sense? If you don't think about consequences, like maybe I'm messing up things, the world, part of the eco world, you know, if I'm not doing things properly, nothing's wrong with thinking in those directions and starting thinking about consequences. That's how we change our behavior. That's how we do different things. And that's the same way with our sexuality. We have to look at what may potentially is the consequence of our actions. What if everybody lived the way I lived? What would the world look like? That's something I ask all the time. You know, is if everybody did what I did, what would the world look like? Is it a better place, or is it not so good of a place? You know, what is the consequences for my sexual decisions? And so, you know, giving God over those intimate parts of our life. Some people, you know, go, hey, yeah, but I'm in a marriage and everything, and I have just sex with my wife, and my wife has just sex with me, and so I must be doing great, you know? Well, I would say check yourself as well, you know? What kind of sex are you having? And you go, whoa, what does that mean? Well, that's a whole other topic, but I mean, you know, how's your heart in it? How are you walking in your intimate life? Again, everything is about giving things over to the Lord, giving your heart over to God, learning how to love your neighbor, love God, even in the marital bed. We don't get rid of Jesus in the marital bed. No, God's right there with us, and his love should be in there as well. It says, for God has not called us to be dirty-minded and full of lust, but to be holy and clean. Man, what good convicting words for me, for sure. If anyone refuses to live by these rules, he is not disobeying the rules of men, but of God. So Paul says, this has nothing to do with me as a man saying this thing. This isn't some patriarchy. This isn't some, you know, misogynistic. This isn't anything that I'm putting. This is something that God's talked about. One man, one woman, for life. And if it seems narrow, it is. It's super narrow. And that's why he says living more closely to that ideal. It's an ideal. It's something we are aiming for. But if you're not aiming for anything, well, then you certainly ain't gonna hit anything, right? You're not aiming for nothing. You're just throwing the dart. But man, if you're aiming for something, you're focused on it, then you have a place where you go, hey, that's the ideal. That's where I need to go. That's the example. You know, let me move in that direction. And that's what we want to do. So it says God has called us in this way, and he has given us his Holy Spirit to help us with this. It says, but concerning the pure brotherly love that there should be among God's people, I don't need to say much. He says, for God himself is teaching you to love one another. Indeed, your love is already strong toward all the Christian brothers throughout the whole nation. Even so, dear brothers, we beg you to love them more and more. So Paul again affirms all the things that are going awesome. So you get the idea that it's not like things are all just a mess in Thessalonica. No, they've been really awesome in so many ways, and Paul's sharing that. But he also says, hey, I want you to be aware of this as well, you know. And so he continues his teaching. So I want you to see just that balance of how we can live in our life, that we can help people out by affirming and encouraging them, but also coming alongside those people and continually be helping them to teach them. And that's how we should be receiving things from other people too. We should be receiving encouragement, but we also should be receiving any kind of form of correction that they might give us as well in the Lord. And that would be good. You know, the foolish person does not take correction well. So we want to take it really well, right? We want to be able to take correction. We want to be able to know the ideal and move in those directions. So it says, this should be your ambition, which is to love your neighbor. And it says to live a quiet life, minding your own business and doing your own work. That's pretty cool, right? Don't be a busybody. Don't be in other people's business. But it says, mind your own business. Be quiet. Live a quiet life. And I love that. Working hard, being diligent. And are those things in my life today? Am I working hard? Am I being diligent? Am I living a quiet life? Or am I kind of stirring up a lot of dissension, a lot of strife? Am I that person? Am I causing a lot of heartache on people? Or am I a person that kind of lightens their load? I'm a peaceful person to be around. Or am I very difficult to be around? You know, a quiet life, someone who's, you know, minding my own business. I just love those ideas. It says, just as we told you before, as a result, people who are not Christians will trust and respect you and will not need to depend on others for enough money to pay your bills. And you will not need to depend on others. So there's something to be said about that Christian work ethic, to work and support yourself, to do your best to do that, and to mind your own business, to not get meddling into other people's things. You know, to really stay in your lane, man, stay focused on you and your world. And, you know, Jesus said, hey, sufficient is the evil of today. And sometimes we can get so focused on the next day that we forget about just what we got going on today. So the encouragement, Paul says, is, hey, love your neighbor, continue to love, continue to affirm. I want to continue to do that with people. And I want to, you know, have a good work ethic. I want to live a life that I'm not in other people's business. I'm not creating strife. And I'm a peaceful guy. I want people to find peace around me. So it says, and now, dear brothers, I want you to know what happens to a Christian when he dies, so that when it happens, you will not be full of sorrow, so that those who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and came back to life again, we can also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him all Christians who have died. I can tell you this directly from the Lord, that we who are still alive, when the Lord returns, will not rise to meet him ahead of those who are in their graves. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a mighty shout, and with the soul-stirring cry of the archangel and the great trumpet call of God. And the believers who are dead will be first to rise to meet the Lord. Then we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air and remain with him forever. So comfort and encourage each other with this news. So Paul gives wonderful encouragement, and he just simply answers a question about what happens to Christians when they die, and what happens when Christ comes back, when they're going to get their resurrected body, so to speak. Now, Paul just says that, hey, when Jesus has this, when he comes to in the clouds, it says this moment where he comes in the clouds, kind of an interesting idea there. It says the people that are dead, already believers, will rise from the dead. And it says then the second thing that will happen, those who are still alive and remain, will be actually changed and will be caught up. That's where we get the word rapture, by the way. If you've ever heard the rapture of the church, we will be caught up with them in the air to meet the Lord. You know, all I could think about with this, to really simplify it, is just, have you ever heard of the ascension of Christ? You know, Jesus ascended into heaven. And when he ascended into heaven, it says that he went up into the clouds. And all I could say is, like, we are going to, in a sense, have an ascension, you know, where, you know, there's going to be a moment where we will go up and meet, and God will come down and we'll meet him in the clouds, it says. Really interesting. Now, the picture, of course, always that the Bible paints about this time is Jesus kind of meeting his bride, coming to take his bride to him. So it's a real, I don't want you to think this is just some weird kind of thing that the Bible puts in there and there's no backstory. There is a backstory. And the backstory is that Jesus came to get a bride. And when Jesus came to earth, he purchased the bride through his blood that was shed, which offered forgiveness of sins. Now the church is seen as his bride, and he's going to now come again and take his bride to be with him. And they're gonna be in their bodies. You will have a new body when this happens, whether you are already dead in Jesus Christ or whether you're still on the earth living. You will receive a new body at this point of this time where Jesus comes for his bride, his beloved. And so it says, therefore comfort one another with this. So the Thessalonians might have had a teaching that by some false teacher, who knows, that told them, like, hey, you know what, you missed it. You know, you missed it. Something already happened and you were not a part of it. And Paul says, no way. You know, when Christ comes back, those who are in Christ, your beloved who have died, you will see them again. You will be reunited with them, with the Lord. And that's the encouragement of the reuniting. And, you know, I think sometimes that gives us great hope on this planet, especially as we get older and we see more loved ones dying, that one day there will be a reuniting with them. And it'll be absolutely gorgeous. So he encourages the church with that saying. So, hey, Debbie, it's good to see you too. Man, it's good to be here in the morning Devo with you guys. So we got through chapter 4. I mean, there's a lot to be said. It's a really awesome chapter. But I hope you got some of that, really giving God just the intimate parts of our life. And I know that's tough. Sometimes it's tough. But, you know, it's okay. God knows about us. He made us. He knows our struggles. He knows our lustful inclinations. He knows our being, our frailty, those kind of things. So we can come to him, and he is safe. You know, those who have come to Christ have passed from judgment to life. We can come to him and talk to him about everything of our intimacy. We could continue on to love our neighbors and wanting to earn a living for ourselves to make sure we're living quiet and peaceably. And then being encouraged just about the reuniting once again with our loved ones. And that really the best is yet to come. So, hey, it's good seeing you guys. I'll be back, Lord willing, tomorrow. I am in town. So tomorrow we'll keep it going. We'll finish up Thessalonians in the AM. So you guys take care, okay? Bye-bye.